Good morning, afternoon, evening, night, everyone. Today's video is dedicated to the topic of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. Is it somehow connected to narcissism? And is there a kind of trilateral structure? Autism, ADHD, narcissism. Similar to the dark triad. Okay, let me first clear one of your questions. I've been asked if it is true that psychopaths lack impulse control, how can they climb to the top of the corporate ladder? How can they become leaders of countries? How can they attain any goal? How can they put together teams to work with? If they are goal-oriented, doesn't this conflict with a lack of impulse control, recklessness, and inability to predict the consequences of their actions? Well, it behooves you and is very helpful to make a distinction between types of psychopaths. There is a primary psychopath, there is a secondary psychopath, and there is the dark triad psychopath. Now, the primary psychopath, which I also call the Cleckley psychopath, because it's first been described extensively by Harvey Cleckley. This is the kind of guy who is all over the place. He has no impulse control. He's defiant. He's contumacious. He hates authority and authority figures. He's reckless. He's ruthless. He's callous. He's relentless. He's a nutcase, in short. And that's the kind of psychopath who gets in trouble all the time. And that's the kind of psychopath that Robert Hare started his career with. Robert Hare was a psychologist in correction facilities in Canada. And that's the kind of psychopath he had described. And Cleckley even mentions Robert Hare's work in the fifth edition of his seminal masterpiece, The Mask of Sanity. But then Hare teamed up with another guy, Babiak, and together they started to study corporate psychopaths, and they got a totally different picture. The psychopaths who end up in prison and the psychopaths who end up as chief executive officers of Fortune 500 companies, they're not the same type of psychopath. Now, before we come to that other type of psychopath, secondary psychopath is essentially a borderline. We believe that most people diagnosed with borderline personality disorder, when they are subjected to stress, to anxiety, especially abandonment anxiety, when they endure narcissistic injuries, because most of them are grandiose, they devolve, they become secondary psychopaths. These are psychopaths which maintain a sense of empathy, full-fledged empathy, and have access to emotions, negative and positive. So there's a primary psychopath, it's emotionless, empathyless, nutcase, lacking in impulse control, all over the place, etc., etc. Secondary psychopath who cannot regulate her emotions. She has dysregulated emotions, has labile moods, is hypervigilant, anticipates rejection and abandonment, can't stand it, develops anxiety, is under enormous stress, subjected to narcissistic injuries all the time, and so on, and then she becomes a psychopath. And she acts as a psychopath, but still maintains her empathy and feeling. And there's a third type of psychopath. It's a member of the dark triad. Now, the dark triad is a set of traits: narcissism, psychopathy, and Machiavellianism. And it is the Machiavellian element that endows these psychopaths with the capacity to plan ahead, with the capacity to anticipate the consequences of their actions, and with a lot of impulse control, and the ability to be pro-social when needed, put together people to work towards a common goal. So these are the kind of psychopaths who end up being politicians, or senior corporate figures, or clergymen, or, you know, people who work with other people, and they're pro-social. And there's also a pro-social communal narcissist who has the same more or less characteristics. So Machiavellianism is the components that's missing. And now there's another new suggested confluence of traits and behaviors. It's known as the dark tetrad. And the dark tetrad adds to the mix a secondary psychopath or a borderline or a covert narcissist. So it's all the above: narcissist, psychopath, Machiavellian, and plus lability, emotional dysregulation, mood swings. In other words, plus borderline characteristics, which lead to secondary psychopathy. So within the dark tetrad, we would find covert narcissists who, under pressure and stress, become essentially primary psychopaths. We would find borderlines who anticipate abandonment and rejection, develop anxiety, and become secondary psychopaths. And within the dark tetrad, these people would have long-term careers. They would be very self-efficacious. They would obtain and extract favorable outcomes from their environment, etc., etc. So this is where the confusion comes from. Psychopathy is not only a spectrum, but it's a typology. It's like saying bacteria. You have, you know, hundreds of bacteria. Millions of bacteria. It's like saying viruses or coronavirus. Coronavirus is a family. It's the same with the psychopath. The secondary, primary, dark triad, dark tetrad. I mean, there's variants of psychopathy. And you can't put all of them in one basket. When I talk about psychopaths in my video, if I don't mention the qualifier, secondary or dark triad or whatever, I mean a primary psychopath. I mean a cleckly psychopath. A psychopath who is dysregulated, discombobulated, unable to control his impulses, his rage, his envy, his negative emotionality, separates his negative emotionality from his positive emotionality and represses his positive emotionality to the point of vanishing. Has no empathy except cold empathy, the ability to scan cognitively and reflexively other people and, you know, spot their vulnerabilities and then leverage the vulnerabilities to obtain goals. So that's a goal-oriented type of psychopath. And so this mixing is common, unfortunately, especially online, where many self-styled experts and wannabe experts and would-be experts and have been experts and so on and so forth, they tend to confuse narcissists with psychopaths, with secondary psychopaths, with borderlines, with CPTSD. I mean, it's a complete taxonomic, hopeless classificatory mess and chaos out there, because people who don't have a clue what they're talking about present themselves as experts and made enormous diagnostic mess. So today, if you want to know who is who and who's doing what to whom, you must attend a university. In my own small way, I'm trying to bring the university to you. I'm trying to teach you what we teach in academic institutions. Because what we teach in academic institutions is based on scholarship, is based on studies, on research. We don't accept all research unquestioningly. That's why we try to repeat the experiments. That's why we try to conduct other experiments to elucidate and criticize aspects of previous studies, previous scholarship. So there's a process, it's called the scientific method, by which we obtain knowledge that is ever closer to what we believe to be some kind of ideal truth. And this is called the asymptotic process. This is the way to do science. That's the way to learn things. You can't just wake up in the morning and say, wow, there's a lot of money in narcissism and psychopathy. I'll declare myself an expert. I'll declare myself an expert because when I was 16, I met a psychopath. He was sitting at the next table. I watched him for 1 hour. That makes me an expert. It's a mess online. It's a serious mess. The other day, someone wrote to me and said, Sam, do you know that your videos are shadow banned on YouTube? YouTube had eliminated your videos from the search results and from the algorithms that recommend videos to people. And of course, there's no such thing as shadow banning. That's yet another conspiracy theory. Social medium will either ban you or ignore you. But there's no middle ground. There's no like shadow banning. They don't tweak the algorithm for my sake. I'm not that grandiose. My videos are simply not of interest to people. People don't watch my videos. They don't click on them when they are recommended. People don't think my videos are relevant to their lives. They don't find them helpful. And I'm in very good company. Kernberg, Otto Kernberg, is the father of the profession. He is the one who had described borderline personality disorder in great detail. He's the father of the diagnosis. He is also the most preeminent scholar after Franz Kohut in the field of narcissism. The most preeminent experimental psychologist in narcissism is Keith Campbell, who usually collaborates with Jan Twenge. And so both Campbell and Kernberg have videos online, believe it or not. If you search for Kernberg borderline or Kernberg narcissism, you'll find interviews with him, videos with him. You'll find videos by Campbell. And yet these videos get no views. Kernberg, I think, has 15,000 views. 15,000 views. Any coach's dog gets more than this. Any narcissistic abuse coach gets more than this in the first hour of posting a video. I'm the guy who coined the phrase narcissistic abuse. I'm the first to have to describe it 25 years ago. And I don't get a fraction of the viewership that hundreds of self-styled experts on narcissistic abuse get. Kernberg is the same. Keith Campbell gave an interview 4 years ago about narcissism. This is the guy. We base all our knowledge of narcissism on his studies, on his scholarship. He's the pillar, he's the rock, the experimental rock upon which we build our citadels of knowledge. And Campbell gave an interview about his work in narcissism. And to this very day, 4 years later, he has 76,000 views, which is nothing. Nothing. I can show you guys who can hardly speak in the back and shooting videos in the backs of cars, and they get 70,000 views within 2 days. 2 days, not 4 years. I'm in good company. I'm with Kernberg. I'm with Campbell. I'm with C.G. Jung. Jung videos typically get 20,000-30,000 views. Jung, Carl Jung. Rare videos with Freud and videos from the 50s and 60s with Perls, the father of Gestalt. These videos get 10, 15, 7,000 views. People don't want scholarship. What are people looking for? Echo. People are looking for echoes. People are looking for other people to tell them that they are right, that they are victims, that they had done nothing wrong, that they are superior in some way, they have a lot of empathy, that their knowledge, self-imputed knowledge, is actually not anecdotal but expertise. People want to see on the screen people who are exactly like them. And so there's a mutual admiration society going on. It's a manifestation of narcissism, of course. The whole field of narcissism and narcissistic abuse in social media is infested, absolutely contaminated with narcissists teaching narcissists, narcissists talking to covert narcissists, narcissists and covert narcissists paying money to narcissists and covert narcissists and psychopaths, con artists who pretend to be empathic and loving and helpful. This is the scene. Real experts, real scholars, and I am not talking about myself. I'm talking about the likes of Kernberg and Jung and Freud and Keith Campbell and Twenge, and, you know, I can go down the list. Have you heard of a single of the names I've mentioned in my previous video? Have you heard of Glasser, the father of the core complex? Of course you haven't. Of course you haven't. The real experts, the real scholars, the people who know what they're talking about, 100,000%, they don't dare put themselves out on YouTube. It's a swamp. It's a toxic swamp. And I don't deserve any credit for being online and for making videos and so on. We all know I'm a narcissist, I'm a psychopath, I'm doing it for narcissistic supply. I'm not quite sure what kind of supply I'm getting. All my videos are free, ad-free. I am not promoting or selling any products, as you see. I'm not pushing retreats like some self-styled experts. I'm not pushing courses like some coaches. I'm just giving you information, that's all. But okay, forget all this. I am here, and if I deserve credit and applause for anything, it's my courage in putting myself out there as a scholar. Because guys, you hate experts, you hate scholars, you hate medical doctors. Poor Dr. Fauci is afraid for his life. You hate science. You hate knowledge. It's an age of occult and nonsense and religion and con artists and gurus and mystics and yogis and coaches and liars who pretend to have doctorates. Yes, many of the so-called doctors online are not doctors. And you enable these people. You are people pleasers because you don't do your homework. You don't ask difficult questions. You ask me difficult questions because I'm a narcissist. I'm a narcissist. You have the right to abuse me. But you don't dare. You don't dare write a similar message to Dr. So-and-so. Excuse me. You claim to be a doctor. In which university? What year? Where are you teaching? What have you published? No. You don't dare. You're cowards. Simple. You are knowledge-hating cowards. And still, I'm going to continue to make videos. And I'm going to continue to try to penetrate this veil and this firewall of ignorance, self-imputed, self-inflicted ignorance. And I hope that one day you will wake up and you will begin to make a distinction between well-substantiated, well-researched information and data and rank nonsense coming out of someone's delirium, very often drug-induced delirium, alcohol-induced delirium. Thank you for listening.